Muy buenas tardes a todos. Vamos a dar paso ahora a la conferencia magistral. Estamos de moderadores, pues Eulogio y yo misma. Y la verdad es que estamos muy contentos de tener a Peter Widinsky aquí con nosotros. Nos va a dar una charla sobre los 20 años de angioplastia primaria para el tratamiento del infarto, la experiencia y evolución de las redes de infarto. Esto es la parte así, la oficial. La verdad es que delante de personas como Petr, estamos realmente, we are very pleased to having you here. Really, you are a very close friend. Él se graduó en la Charles University de Praga en el 79, después se fue a Holanda del 91 al 93, allí estuvo en Rotterdam, después en Zwolle. En el 93 volvió a Checoslovaquia y allí hubo también una revolución, no solo la revolución social, sino la revolución en cardiología. Se miraron de ver cuántos hospitales terciarios podían haber, etcétera, etcétera, y a él se le permitió pues implementar lo que había aprendido pues en Holanda. Me explicaba un día, íbamos en coche en Praga y me estaba diciendo que lo que hacía era coger todos los catéteres, you bring all the catheters, ¿no? y para llevarlos a su país, entonces los esterilizaba. La policía lo cogía, le decía, ¿dónde va con todo esto? Esto son bombas, etcétera, etcétera. No, que no son bombas, que son catéteres. Bueno, siempre tenía problemas de estos, pero la verdad es que se llevaba todos los catéteres para poderlos utilizar allá. Porque quería que su país pues, pudiera ser igual que el sitio donde había estado trabajando. Entonces, en el 96 fundó uno de los mayores centros de cardiología, que es el que él dirige, y realmente ahora la cardiología en Praga es él. Y en el 99 hubo una revolución en la Sociedad Europea de Cardiología, presentó el Praga 1, y en que allí se vio que realmente la angioplastia primaria no era solo una cosa que se pudiera hacer en los centros en que había angioplastia primaria, sino que los pacientes se podían transferir y que los resultados eran mejores que la trombólisis. Y esto fue el principio de la revolución. Praga 1, Praga 2, Praga 3, estamos en el Praga 14. En el 2008, con William Wilms y Susana Kaifosova, fundaron el Stem for Life, esta iniciativa para que promover el acceso equitativo en todo el territorio europeo de los pacientes para tener el mejor tratamiento en el síndrome del coronario agudo. Fue para Europa, pero ahora realmente se está expandiendo. Está en India, ¿no? Está en Sudamérica, está empezado, se firmó la última declaración con México. Actualmente es el presidente de la Sociedad Checa de Cardiología. Su interés ahora está en la revista Coret Basa, que de ser una revista local ahora la mayoría de los artículos vienen de fuera, de otros países, y ahora está muy dedicado. Él vio muy claro que se tenía que hacer la angioplastia primaria, que los pacientes se podían transferir, se podían revascularizar, pues que puede pasar lo mismo que con el accidente cerebrovascular. Y en eso está metido, seguro que se saldrá con la suya. De momento ya ha conseguido que no se haga trombólisis, que es lo que hacían los neurólogos. El año pasado se le dio el reconocimiento a su labor en el premio en la conferencia Andreas Grundzig, y ahora nuestro pequeño homenaje es tenerlo aquí. Realmente para nosotros es un placer tenerlo aquí y que nos pueda dar esta charla. Tú, me he extendido, pero…
No, yo creo que si preguntáramos a todos vosotros ahora cuál es el objetivo principal de… en el infarto agudo de miocardio, que es lo que os preocupa, todo el mundo diría que obtener una reperfusión óptima. En los años 90, Peter Widinsky, esto con muy escasos medios, como habéis visto, y con mucha energía e ilusión, consiguió, yo creo que una cosa más importante, es demostrar y convencer a la gente de que lo importante era hacer angioplastia. Primero lo importante era hacer una coronariografía y después angioplastia. Y para aquellos pacientes que llegaban a hospitales sin medios de hemodinámica, que fueran transferidos a hospitales con hemodinámica lo antes posible. él siempre desconfió de pues eso, la comodidad de la angioplastia facilitada del día siguiente, y tampoco creyó mucho en esto, en las promesas de la regeneración de los territorios no perfundidos. Yo creo que eso estaba hecho para gente con más pausa, y que al final pues se ha demostrado que tenía razón, y por eso yo creo que es para nosotros un honor tenerlo aquí. Peter, it's a great honor to have you with us, and thank you for coming. Okay.
Dear friends, dear colleagues, first of all, it's a great pleasure for me to be here, and I would like to heartily thank for the invitation to this wonderful place. I came yesterday evening with my wife, and we enjoyed the city of Cordoba this morning. It's really a marvelous place with a great history. I unfortunately don't speak Spanish, so I couldn't understand what was said, but I guess that they were very kind. So also thank you for this introduction. And my task today is to go with you during the 20 years of primary angioplasty for STEMI, of course, with focus on our own activities in this field. In the second part of my talk, I will mention some of the recent developments in this area. So, if there is an obstructed root, we have to reopen the root and to remove the obstruction. Before 1985, there was no routine treatment available. There were some attempts with thrombolysis, but nothing was used routinely. Between 1986 and 1993, this was the time, the golden time for thrombolysis, which was developed after the first randomized trials. And this was, however, available only for approximately 25% of all STEMI patients because of timing, because of contraindications, and so on. In 1993 to 2002, the angioplasty was started in this field and slowly developed. But during this period, primary angioplasty was offered only to patients who were living around the PCI centers. And after 2002, this was enabled also to patients living more far, who needed transport from either from one hospital to the other hospital, or directly from home to longer distance to PCI center. These are some faces related to the history. We are very proud that Otto Klein was the cardiologist working in Prague in 1929, and he was the first who performed diagnostic cardiac catheterization in human patients. Andreas Grinzig is very well known as the founder of angioplasty in 1977, and Geoff Hartzler from US is less known, that he performed first primary angioplasty already in 1982, so just 5 years later after Grinzig in stable angina. And Felix Zijlstra and the Zwolle group in the Netherlands, where I was happy to be trained for angioplasty, performed the first randomized trial showing the superiority of primary PCI over thrombolysis. These are the key data from the first randomized Zwolle trial, which was published in the New England Journal of Medicine 1993. And I was lucky that I was in that given period, I was there in Zwolle for training, and I became very enthusiastic for primary angioplasty. It was a great honor for me that a couple of years later, during my term in the ESC board, I had the chance to award Hari Suryapranatha, who was my closest teacher from the Zwolle group, and to award him Andreas Grinzig Prize. And later I was honored to receive the same prize as well. If we go to the modern therapy of acute myocardial infarction, we were speaking already about thrombolysis and primary angioplasty. The major difference between these two treatments is in two ways. Thrombolysis is able to open only about half of the arteries. And in the other half of the patients, the thrombolysis has no effect at all, just brings the risk. While primary angioplasty is able to open 90% of those arteries and with less bleeding risk. And also, furthermore, thrombolysis, because it doesn't remove the underlying stenosis, has much greater reocclusion risk than primary PCI. This is the summary of comparison between primary PCI and thrombolysis, which basically are the data which I just mentioned. The differences also in strokes and in mortality and so on. You know, I think, all these data. This is an example of a young man with severe inferior infarction with cardiogenic shock due to acute occlusion of the right coronary artery and acute occlusion of the obtuse marginal artery treated by angioplasty. The first PRAGUE trial was mentioned already in the introduction, and there was another trial running simultaneously, and this was done in the Netherlands in the Maastricht area by Dr. Vermeer and colleagues, and these trials came to almost the same conclusions. And this is the meta-analysis of these two trials showing that primary PCI is the most advantageous treatment for the patient, better than thrombolysis, but also better than facilitated PCI. Later, there was ASCENT-4 study, and interestingly, when we published the PRAGUE-1 study in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2000, there was a critical editorial written by Franz van der Werf telling that routine transport of STEMI patients to PCI center is not acceptable. And 6 years later, the ASCENT-4 study prepared by Franz van der Werf came basically to very similar results as the PRAGUE-1 study. When we finished PRAGUE-1 study, which had only 300 patients randomized into three groups, so there were about 100 patients per each group. So we were discussing with the Czech healthcare authorities, with the Ministry of Health and with the insurance companies, whether these data are sufficient to allow to change the strategy in the whole country. And the answer was no, because of the small number of patients. So we prepared PRAGUE-2 study, which was much larger, which covered half of the country with 51 hospitals participating. And these are the data from PRAGUE-2 study showing clear benefit from PCI over thrombolysis. And this is only in patients who needed transport. And this is a known meta-analysis of 23 studies published by Keeley and co-workers, showing, again, confirming that PCI is better than thrombolysis to treat acute myocardial infarction. And especially if you combine endpoint of mortality, reinfarction, and stroke, the decrease, the improvement is basically 50% from 14 to 8. Going back to the Czech Republic and to our experience with primary PCI and with STEMI networks, the activity in my own hospital started already in 1982 when we did the first intracoronary thrombolytic treatment of acute myocardial infarction. And then in 1995, we did this study with medical students. And our medical students visited 11 different hospitals in the Czech Republic and went through the patient records and analyzed the mortality from ST elevation myocardial infarction. And they found these great differences in mortality for the same disease based only on the hospital type and on the availability of cardiologists and availability of PCI. So the same disease in one hospital had mortality 29% and in another hospital 8%. So of course we thought this is not acceptable. We must change this. So we started first in our hospital and we stopped using thrombolysis completely in 1995. So the last treatment of infarction by thrombolysis in my hospital was 19 years ago. And this is the effect of this change from year to year on our mortality. So the last year when thrombolysis was used, 1994, the mortality was 11%, And the first year when only primary angioplasty was used, the mortality was 4%. So then we were thinking how to offer this benefit also to other patients, not only to those living around our hospital. So we were preparing the design of the Prague 1 study, randomizing patients in small non-PCI hospitals with patients with ST elevation myocardial infarction, randomizing them into three groups. One group was thrombolysis in the nearest hospital, so in the hospital where they presented, what was in that time the treatment recommended by the guidelines. Second group was facilitated PCI, so thrombolysis was started in that hospital and patients were transferred. And the third group was transport to primary PCI from the small hospital to PCI center without thrombolysis. When we presented this design of study to our Ministry of Health and applied for grant support, this is in Czech, you cannot read it, but this is the critics which we received from the conservative scientific board of the health ministry, and the result downstairs here is 4, what means that the study is very poor and has no value. And we decided to do the study basically without any support, just from the enthusiasm of all these investigators, and then the data came out, and here you see the most important finding, which is the long-term outcome from the Prague 2 trial, and this is the 5 years outcome after PCI, and this is 5 years outcome after thrombolysis. So after finishing Prague 2 study, there was already very clear agreement between the cardiologist community in our country and also the healthcare authorities, the Ministry of Health and insurance companies, that primary PCI should be the treatment of choice for acute myocardial infarction. And thus, the Czech Society of Cardiology published the new guidelines in 2002 in our journal Core et Vasa. And this is the key table from these guidelines, clearly showing that primary PCI should be used for treatment of all acute myocardial infarctions, with only one subgroup exception where thrombolysis is still acceptable. And these are patients presenting early in the course of infarction and having very long time to primary PCI. Basically, these patients today don't exist in our country. We were proud that the Czech Society of Cardiology was the first scientific society to publish such guidelines. The European Society published similar recommendation 1 year later, and the American College of Cardiology and American Heart 2 years later. This is the evolution of PCI rates in the Czech Republic from 1990 to 2013, and you see the sharp increase in the same period where Prague studies were done and completed. And now in the last year, it remains stable. Our population is slightly more than 10 million, so the rate per million is around 2,200. This is the map of the Czech Republic with the PCI networks. The red circles are PCI centers, and the black lines with numbers are distances in kilometers. So if you can see, probably the longest distance is here, 140 kilometers between Prague and Budweis. And so if a patient in the middle of this distance is suffering from infarction, the distance either here or here is 70 kilometers. So there is no village in the country with longer transfers than 70 kilometers for primary PCI. And this is how this influenced the differences in mortality of acute myocardial infarction in different hospitals. This is a situation in 1999 in hospital mortality in PCI centers and in hospitals without PCI facilities. And this is the same data from same hospitals just 6 years later, when all patients were already transferred and the difference in mortality completely disappeared. And then we were invited to create the Stand for Life project, which actually was the idea of William Vines and myself in 2008. And I was honored to be the first chairman of this project, and these are the data from the first survey we completed in 2008. Data are basically from 2007. And here you see the countries in Europe where primary PCI was implemented basically for all patients, for the entire population. These are Netherlands, Germany, Poland, Czech Republic, Switzerland, and Sweden in 2007. And then the Stand for Life was focused on improving the situation in other countries. And this was interesting finding from this first part of Stand for Life, which showed that if the nationwide strategy for treatment myocardial infarction is thrombolysis, then 46% of patients are not treated at all because of contraindications of thrombolysis, because of age, because of timing, and so on. And if primary PCI is treatment of choice in the country, then only 7% of patients are not treated. So this is very important difference. The Stand for Life project was continuing. I had to step down because I became president of the Czech Society of Cardiology, and it was time demanding both, so I couldn't do both at once. So I decided to step out, and Sten Dalby-Christensen took the chair for next 2 years, and he published recently the findings 4 years later. So these data are from 2010 or 11, and you see how the map of the Europe is much more blue. So in many countries, the situation dramatically improved, including your country, including UK and Turkey, for instance. Bulgaria made a great step ahead, and so on. So we were speaking so far about STEMI, and what about non-STEMI? Patients with non-ST segment elevation myocardial infarction frequently present with a critical stenosis. And actually, for these patients, sometimes we can do more than for STEMI, because if we treat them properly, we can completely save their ventricles, their myocardium, and prevent any myocardial damage, basically, or almost any. We did a small study called VINO, which was published in 2002, and which was actually not planned to be a mortality study, but surprisingly, it showed mortality benefit in patients with non-STEMI treated invasively versus those treated conservatively. The ESC guidelines for patients with non-STEMI recommend that there is a subgroup of patients with non-STEMI, and the subgroup is defined on this slide, and these patients require fast treatment, quick intervention in a similar way to STEMI. A very interesting article was written by Professor Braunwald in Circulation last year, and he is expecting that in future unstable angina will maybe disappear because of high sensitivity troponins and improvement of our diagnostics. And he suggested at the end of this article that a requiem is a choral musical work that is performed at the funeral of a great personage or at the close of an important era. And he puts himself the question, and to us the question, has not the time arrived to prepare a requiem for unstable angina? So this is kind of discussion which is now ongoing in cardiology community. And very soon after this article was published, by chance, we had the opportunity to welcome Professor Braunwald in Prague and give him a honorary doctorate of the Charles University. And we discussed a lot, and then we published a position statement of the Czech Society of Cardiology, which goes wider and which goes to the classification of all acute coronary syndromes. And basically, our idea is to discuss the abandonment of ST segment-based classification and to classify based on whether ongoing myocardial ischemia is present or not. And this is the table showing the change. So the final diagnosis is not changed, but the acute working diagnosis at the first contact is proposed to be changed in this. Of course, this is just a proposal which is now widely discussed in the medical community. as I said in the beginning, in the second part of my presentation, I will touch some of the hot topics in acute PCI for acute myocardial infarction. Let me start with this study, which was published recently, and this is the HEAT primary PCI study. How effective are antithrombotic therapies in primary PCI? And this study compared heparin versus bivalirudin, and this was done in the United Kingdom. There are studies published comparing bivalirudin with heparin. However, all these studies had the same problem in the design, that in bivalirudin, most patients did not receive GP inhibitors, while in heparin, almost all patients received GP inhibitors. And obviously, if you combine heparin with GP inhibitors, you have more bleeding. And in all these studies, the difference was done by bleeding, not by ischemia. This HEAT study was a single-center randomized control study in STEMI patients, and this was all-comer studies, or a study reflecting the real life. The study medication was heparin 70 units per kilo pre-procedure and bivalirudin in usual doses, and obciximab was allowed only as bailout in both groups. So this was head-to-head comparison of heparin with bivalirudin under fair conditions with the same use of obciximab. This was the study population, nearly 2,000 patients. And this is a characteristic of the patients and of the treatment. So bailout of GP2-BCR inhibitors was in 13% to 15%. And this is the difference. Heparin was better. And this is the timing to the first major adverse cardiac event. Heparin was better. And these are other data, and especially interesting are data of reinfarction and target lesion revascularization, which was three times more frequent in bivalirudin group. Stent thrombosis more frequent after bivalirudin than after heparin. Primary safety outcomes similar, so similar rates of bleeding after both when was the same use of GP2-BCR inhibitors. So the conclusions of this study was that the use of heparin rather than bivalirudin reduced the rate of major cardiac adverse events and had fewer stent thrombosis and reinfarctions. Another study is the randomized study of preventive angioplasty in myocardial infarction. You know this study as PRAMI study, which was published also recently in the New England Journal of Medicine. And this study compared acute multivessel PCI versus rather conservative approach with culprit-only PCI in the acute phase and medical treatment thereafter, with very strict only indications for eventual late PCI of other branches. And this was recently commented during EuroPCR by Gabriel Steck, so I use a few of his slides here to show the weaknesses of this study and the questions which this study opened. It is known that there is worse prognosis in patients with multivessel disease versus single vessel disease after primary PCI. And after acute coronary syndromes, many recurrent events are related really to non-culprit. So from this point of view, PRAMI study was testing the right question. However, there are also many reports, and this is the most recent meta-analysis, showing that PCI of arteries which are not acutely sick doesn't bring so much benefit. And I will skip a few of these slides. And this is the meta-analysis of revascularization of infarct-related artery and non-infarct-related arteries routinely after primary PCI, and you see that if it is same sitting, so acute multivessel PCI, it favors culprit-only PCI. If it is a staged PCI, which was not tested in PRAMI study, then it favors multi-vessel PCI, but in the staged matter. These are the guidelines from the ESC 2012 for STEMI. Primary PCI should be limited to culprit vessel, with the exception of cardiogenic shock and persistent ischemia after PCI of the supposed culprit lesion. And the last part of my presentation is about, the last part which is dealing with infarction is about bioresorbable vascular scaffolds. And this is the Prague 19 study. Prague 19 is the last running study with the Prague acronym. And this is a registry, this is not a randomized study. And we treat the patients with STEMI since December 2012. We treat all of them with the intention to implant bioresorbable vascular scaffold. And of course, there are many exclusion criteria, which you can see here. So in the end, we implant BVS in 25% of STEMI, and in the rest, we implant other stents or no stents in some situations, as you can imagine. But if we compared those patients who received BVS with patients who received other stent in this registry, then you can see a trend to better outcomes with BVS, but of course, because of small numbers, it is not significant. But what was interesting, what was important, is that the implantation of BVS in acute myocardial infarction is clearly feasible and is safe. These are reasons why it couldn't be implanted. The main reason was that the artery was too big. Absorb stents are manufactured only with size up to 3.5, and our strategy routinely is that if the artery is at least 3.7, we always give 4 mm stent. So to oversize a little bit in acute myocardial infarction setting. So we don't use BVS in these bigger arteries, and they are quite frequent in STEMI. So these are the overall outcomes. So far we have only one death, and some patients are followed more than 1 year already. So they're very, very low mortality. Reinfarction, only one case as well, and this was the same case as the stent thrombosis. There are 3 strokes, but unrelated to the stent. They are related to other things. And there was no clinical restenosis so far. These are some pictures from this BVS implantation from coronary angiography and from OCT. And this OCT demonstrates that endothelialization is already demonstrable after 1 month. And it's much more after 6 months when the surface of the artery is already smooth. The part of the study protocol is that after 1 year, the patients undergo CT coronary angiography. So here you see how the BVS looks on CT. Just the markers are seen, and otherwise the artery looks entirely normal. This is another CT picture. So the conclusions from this first phase of Prague 19 is still running. So this conclusion from the first phase is that BVS implantation in acute STEMI is feasible and safe. With the currently available size spectrum and expiration times, BVS can be used in only about 25 up to 35% of STEMI patients, and availability of 4 mm stent would allow to do it more frequently. OCT can be used safely to control BVS implantation in STEMI, and the study will elucidate the role of CT angiography for long-term BVS patency assessment. And the long-term follow-up, 3 years we are planning now, maybe we will even prolong. So the long-term follow-up will elucidate the future role of BVS in STEMI. And the last part of my talk is about our recent activity, which is focused on acute stroke. Because you know that cardiologists succeeded to decrease mortality of infarction during the last 20 or 25 years from some 25% down to 4-5%. But this is not the case of stroke. In acute stroke, if we are speaking about only moderate or major strokes, not about the small ones, so in moderate to major strokes, the mortality still is about 25%, and the disability is another 25 up to 50%. So only about 25 to 30% with moderate to major stroke recover significantly. So we have to do something for these patients. So we are now trying to start with this activity, which is much more difficult than infarction. This is an example of a patient with occluded medial cerebral artery and no perfusion here. And after thrombus removal, you see the patent artery and perfusion is there. This is another case with medial cerebral artery occlusion. Here is the solitaire stent. And here the thrombus was removed and the artery is again patent. And another case, the same medial cerebral artery and after thrombus removal. And this was one of our most impressive cases. This was a young lady who fell down on the floor at home, and she came very soon to the hospital, and the thrombus was removed by solitaire stent retriever, and she on the table immediately started to speak and started to move, and next day she was willing to go home and she was asking us whether she can go swimming. These are functional outcomes of our patients so far, and you see that nearly half, slightly less than half, it is 48% of patients are recovering well, so they have no severe permanent disability. They are able to talk, they are able to move. And these are our data compared to three recently published randomized trials from the New England Journal of Medicine. And you see that despite we are beginners in this field, that the data are comparable. And finally, this is just a slide summarizing of these Prague studies, which were discussed a little bit today. I discussed about Prague 1 and Prague 2, and then I showed you Prague 19. There were other studies in between, which I cannot mention in the respect of time. And we were happy that many of our presentations were accepted for different hotline or late-breaking clinical trials in ESC or American Congresses or EuroPCR. And recently also, the Czech Society of Cardiology published so-called National Cardiovascular Program. And this is an important document, which is official document recognized by the Ministry of Health and recommending the strategy of treatment of cardiovascular diseases in the country, and of course implementing also primary angioplasty. So let me conclude that the goal of modern cardiology is to keep the roots open. Thank you.
I thank you very much, Peter. I think it's better if you sit here, you know. Tenemos, ¿cuánto? ¿10 minutos? 10 minutos para preguntas y discusión. No sé si esto alguien de la audiencia quiere preguntar. You know, there are many questions, Peter, that you know, we can ask, but just to start for the simplest one. You know, aspiration, all known selective.
There is no agreement even within our group in my hospital. We are five interventionists doing acute cases, and two of us are rather conservative and three are using it much more frequently. You know all these studies. The first study, TAPAS, was very enthusiastic and very positive. Then the second one, the big one, was negative. Mm-hmm. And now we are waiting for the biggest one, okay. for the Canadian coordinated
okay.
trial.
In the same line, you talk about the BBS and what about the you know, special stents? What is your reading of a Master 1 and you know, and just the expectation of Master 2? Do you think that the, you know, cover stents will have any role in this feel or not?
It's difficult to say. I think we need more studies in this field. I think that in acute myocardial infarction, the interventions achieved so good results that it will be difficult to prove it better. And even if we go back to old studies with just balloon, the balloon angioplasty is actually excellent method for acute myocardial infarction. You don't improve patient outcomes with stent implantation, you just decrease the rate of repeat revascularization. But the mortality is the same with just plain balloon. So it's difficult to go further if we have mortality of 4 or 5%. So it depends what kind of endpoint we define for these comparisons.
Yeah, you know, just last word. I saw, in one of your slides that the 12% of your PCIs, I think it was 12%, they are PCI without a stent. You know, we exclude very small vessels. What are the other scenarios where you don't put stents?
In the acute, you speak about the acute setting, about infarctions.
Right. Yeah.
The most frequent patient when we don't put stent is the unsuccessful PCI, which is about 5-6% of primary PCIs. Mm-hmm. So if the success rate of primary PCI is about 93-94%, mm-hmm. in some centers, in the best centers I would say, in some it is 90%. So in those patients in whom the PCI fails, of course, we don't implant stent.
And your recommendation for the huge rights?
For the very big right?
Yeah, right.
Thrombus removal and the drugs.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Tony.
Hi, Peter. In your cath lab, when you finish a case, which is the parameter that you consider as a good result of primary PCI? Timiflow, blush, what do you consider is a good result?
Well, the ideal result, of course, is zero residual stenosis, Timi-3 flow, perfect myocardial blush, and happy patient without pain. But of course, this is not always achievable, but this is achievable in about 60-70% of cases. But I'm still happy if there is a residual lesion less than 20% without dissection, if there is Timi-3 flow. I think the rest is less important.
If you have a case with Timi-3 flow, but let's say blush 0-1, do you stop the case? Do you do something else?
There is no evidence. What should you do? It is difficult. You may consider the antithrombotic treatment. There was a study published, I think, 2007 in New England Journal of Medicine, and that was a small study from Turkey, showing that intracoronary thrombolysis actually in this situation may be something what could be considered. But still, the data are very scarce and in only small groups. So there is nothing routine what I can recommend as a solution for this situation.
Do you consider that there is some place from strong vasodilators in those cases, like netroprusid? There has been some small studies showing a kind of benefit. This is not strong data, of course, but do you think that there is some place for that?
I would be rather skeptical about vasodilators, because what can vasodilator do? If this problem is caused by thrombus in the periphery, vasodilator can maybe move the thrombus a few millimeters further, but not to dissolve it. So I am more a friend of antithrombotic treatment in these cases than vasodilators.
I'd like to,
just only one question. What type of DAPT pretreatment are you giving? When are you using a lot this new antiplatelets like ticagrelor, prasugrel, in the ambulance, at hospital arriving, when?
Before primary PCI, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, the ambulances in our country routinely use aspirin and heparin, and most of them clopidogrel. Some of them are using also prasugrel, few of them are using ticagrelor. But many patients arrive without these P2Y12 inhibitors, so we approximately half of the patients will arrive just on aspirin and heparin, and then we have to decide which we give. And we are now randomizing patients to ticagrelor versus prasugrel. So this is Prague 18 study, which is now running, and which so far has enrolled something like 350 patients. And we are randomizing STEMI patients to receive prasugrel or ticagrelor, so we use both.
I think that as STEM for Life is expanding around the world, the things are changing. Sometimes I have some doubts. We have Claire in the places where the facilities are at least more or less well. That if it's not enough cath labs, you can open another one in order to achieve enough cath labs to 24 hours open for all the patients. But when you go to other countries like Egypt, in the south of Egypt, or in India, they advocate for a pharmacoinvasive strategy. And really, you cannot say no. The best treatment is primary PCI because the guidelines, so on, so on. The reality in that countries probably is different than in our countries. What is your thought about this? What should we recommend to these people? Start with new cath labs or do that they are doing now?
I cannot speak about India. I have no experience with India, and it's a specific country with 1 billion people and so big distances, and so I cannot comment on India. But in most countries which are members of ESC, so let's say Europe and surrounding countries like Mediterranean countries and this, and also the countries of previous Soviet Union like Ukraine, Belarus and these countries, the problem is not that there are no cath labs. The problems are different. The problems are in education of doctors, in willingness of doctors to do during the night and during the weekends. And in some countries, the problem is in the reimbursement of the catheters. In some countries, the problem is in payment for the doctors. Of course, I didn't comment the practical things, but one of the secrets of our success 20 years ago was that hospitals were paying the doctors for doing night PCIs. So if any doctor in Czech Republic was awakened in the middle of the night to go to hospital, he was happy to go there because he received quite sufficient amount of money for it. So you need this kind of financial stimulus. You need to be practical. So these are small practical things which must be resolved, and it's difficult to comment for a country which you don't know precisely. But in general, if you want from me to a general answer, I think the guidelines are written in the right way. So you should decide based on the timing. You should, in every given area, you should be able to predict how long time it will take you to cath lab. If it is less than 1 hour, you should send the patient without thrombolysis. If it is 2 hours, of course you should give thrombolysis.
I think there is one or two, papers on that. Do you move patients to therapy or therapy to patients? You know that there are studies, or at least two studies, where the doctors move to a place where there is a cath lab but there is no doctors, and instead of moving the patient to the hospital where there is cath lab and doctors.
I have no experience with moving doctor to the patient, but I consider this idea crazy. Because it cannot work in the wide range, it cannot work in the respect of time. Because if you think about creating the staff, opening the lab, switching, everything, preparing, I am afraid this cannot work. It can work in a specific area where you have some kind of infrastructure, but it will be much more expensive because you will need much more cath labs, and they will not be experienced enough because they will have few patients. The reality shows that if you have less than 300,000 population, you shouldn't have any cath lab there because you should have too few patients.
Yeah, and The other question is, you know, safety or efficacy on the stents. You know, when people started using drug-eluting stents, you know, then they said, well, it's more efficacious also in acute myocardial infarction because there is less restenosis. Then with the crisis, you know, more bare metallic stents were used. Now with some studies they point that probably the second and third generation drug-eluting stents that are even safer because they have less you know, stent thrombosis. So what do you think? Where should we be? Or, I mean, 40%, 30% or 100% drug-eluting stents?
Not 100%, but today we are using drug-eluting stents in 70 to 80%. And the decision to give a bare metal stent is driven by something else, like patient has atrial fibrillation and needs anticoagulant therapy, like too big artery, which doesn't need drug-eluting stent. If the artery is 4 millimeters or more, you can use bare metal stent and that's fine. And another thing is, of course, that you should always oversize. The most important reason for restenosis is not the stent, but it is the doctor.
What do you think about the use of preconditioning to improve the results of primary PCN?
I cannot comment because I have no personal experience. The literature data look interesting, but they are still small. But I have no personal experience. We are not using it, but maybe it's our mistake.
Okay, I just want to know exactly because maybe I missed it. You said you were 5 cardiologists doing primary angioplasty, is that right? 5.
In my hospital we are 5, yes.
Yeah. How many primary angioplasties you are doing every year?
How many primary angioplasties?
Yes,
or
please.
All?
Yeah, no, primary angioplasty.
Primary angioplasty, about 300-400.
400, okay. Now, I just wanted to know if how many you were doing, because 5 persons in a cath lab is not very much. So 400 is okay. Okay, thank you.
¿Alguna pregunta más? Well, you know, thanks again for coming here and like always being so clear, you know. And I think we should be thankful because you started one thing that is not always so easy to do. That is just to start what was the original network. You know, in a place where there were no many facilities to start a network, and I think that's, you know, the beginning of the new treatment for acute myocardial infarction. Thank you. Congratulations.
Thank you.